to load all the data in the memory. So you have to load only the row that is pointed by this cursor object, and you can save a lot of processing by using this. You can save the RAM, also the processing. So that was the cursor. So here I have this cursor, and using this cursor I am getting this I am executing this getString method, and this is the query, database.query, and inside this query you can pass the table, the columns, the selection, the group by, and the order, different clauses that you use in your SQL, and these are ordered separately, so you can define anything here. And if you don't have anything, you can pass the null there. So what I'm doing, I'm passing the table name, and then and then I'm passing the column names here. So I have to pass the column names so that these columns will be returned to me, the data inside these columns will be returned to me. So when I execute this query, the database, the table name with the following columns will be returned to me. And if I get back to the code, what I'm getting, I'm receiving this cursor inside the cursor object which is defined here in my main thread. So to get the columns, what you can use, you can use the method getColumnCount. To get the rows, you can simply use the method getCount, and there the column names. If you want to get the column names with the names, the column names, you can store them in an array using the column names here. So here what I'm doing, I'm displaying the result, the text view with number of columns is equal to the column that I have defined here. That means that I have number of columns is equal to 3. The number of rows will be defined by this row item. It will give you the number of rows present in your database, and then number names of columns. So by using this name of columns, I'm using a for each loop here. If you are familiar with this for each loop, for each item I'm displaying this item using the result. So this is very simple, I guess. If you have any questions while displaying this four lines in the emulator, this is what I'm doing here. Please reply me on the chat if it is clear to you. I'm displaying just four lines right now. The name, number of columns, the number of rows, the name of the columns, and okay, I'm getting some replies. Please again tell about the cursor. Yeah, sure, that is what I wanted. Please ask me the questions. Okay, the query, any query in the SQLite database returns a cursor object, and the cursor points to a single row. So here I have this cursor. So here I have this cursor, and when I call this method database.query, it will return me a cursor type object, and this cursor will be pointing to the current database. Let me explain this by using this paint if I can. Let's suppose this is your database, and you have this the first row, the second row, the third row, and the fourth row. And now I have a cursor. Let's suppose this is the cursor. First, what it will do when I define the cursor, it will be pointing to the first row. Only the first row will be fetched into the memory. And when I call this method move next, okay, just let me complete this code. There is one line remaining, and then I will tell you the complete procedure of cursor. Using this cursor, you can define a for loop. And what is happening here? Cursor dot move to first. This will move the cursor to the first. If cursor is not after last, that means this is the condition that cursor should not be after last, after the last entry. And if that happens, you can get out of the loop. And for increment, what I do, cursor dot move to next, moving the cursor to the next entry. And then I'm getting the strings from the cursor depending upon the index, and I'm displaying it as a result, and I'm closing the cursor, and I'm also closing the database, and I'm setting the text to the TV names. Okay, so now let's try to understand how this cursor is working. First, this cursor is pointing to the first row. Then when I call this move to next method, it is pointing to the second row now. So only the second row is inside this memory. When I again call this move to next, it is at the third row now. And if I call the method move to first, it will be here at the first row. That is the first line. And if it is after last, that means it is here at the null. So in that case, you can get out of the loop and you can display the result. Anubhav says, okay, I got it. So please reply once again if the cursor is clear to you. Yeah, clear. Okay. Just let me. All right. Okay, so this is the database handling and the database, how you can manipulate with the database, how you can insert and pass data into your database. So let us see how where this database is present. Let me go into this DDMS, and when I click on this file explorer, I go into the data, again into the data, and I don't remember what is the package name, sorry for that. com.adureka.sqlite.example. So you have to find com.adureka. Okay, com.adureka.sqlite.example. This is the one, and this is the database. If you can see this database folder, and if I click on this, this is the names.db file. That is the database here. Please reply on the chat if you can find this database inside your emulator. That you can find easily. You can push this file out of the device, save it at the desktop. And there's a plugin, free plugin for you in the Firefox. And also you can download this from other sources also. This is SQLite database. This is SQLite Manager plugin for Firefox only. If you want a separate SQLite Manager, you can download it from the net. That is free. And here you can connect this database from the desktop. This is my names.db file. And if I click on this, you can see all the tables here. So Android does not provide us to look into the tables very clearly. So you don't have any particular standard method to view the tables inside your database. So that is one way to get the data, to see the data, how your data looks like. Okay, so I have these three tables. These are some custom defined tables from the Android itself. And then I have this TV names. That is the table that I have defined, and it says row ID is 2, name is Anubhav, and the number is whatever it is. Okay, so you can download this SQLite Manager to see what your database looks like. If it is clear to you, Anubhav, please reply on the chat. Or if you have any question, please reply if you have any question right now. Yeah, please ask the question. Anubhav says, but I have one more question and he wants to speak. Yes, I have unmuted you, Abhishek. Sorry, Anubhav, you can ask your question.
Hello. Okay, yeah. I like to know one thing. We have three ways to store data and fetch data in the application. Like okay. One from files and one from using JSON object and one from database.
Yeah.
So can you tell me and use case where we should recommend to use a database and we should not use database?
Okay.
Any guidelines or any or some tips like that?
Okay. So if let's suppose your application is limited and it has to store the data into database, and in that case let me suggest you an application like autocomplete or a dictionary. If you have a dictionary, if you are making a project like dictionary, what you can do, you can store all the fields into the database. Okay, or if you are getting some data of the user that you don't want to share with other applications, you can use a database for that. But if you want something to be public, your application could use the JSON also in that case if you want to fetch from the HTTP. Well, I don't have the in that case you don't have very clear guidelines. That depends upon your project, what project you are working upon. So previously I was working on a project that is customizing an autocomplete text view, like you are entering some search queries and the autocomplete text view are reflecting those queries. So in that case it is very better to use the SQLite database, because the application will show the results in the autocomplete text view instead of using a dynamic string.